Check one. Check one.
afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming out this afternoon. My name is Fawn Last. I'm an assistant professor of geology in the physics and geosciences department here at ASU. Can everybody hear me okay? Talking into this okay? No? You can't hear me? Can you hear me now? Yes, okay. Can you hear me now? Thank you for coming out. My name is Fawn Last. I'm an assistant professor here in geology in the Department of Physics and Geosciences at Angelo State. First thing I would like to do is extend my gratitude to the West Texas Medical Associates for funding 41 years of this distinguished lecture series in science, honoring Dr. Roy E. Moon. This is a wonderful thing that you are doing for ASU and for the community of San Angelo. I was thrilled to be asked, and it is with great pleasure that I introduce our distinguished lecturer. I've known John for about 17 years. His CV has an index, so I'm going to keep it brief with his accomplishments. He has degrees from some of Canada's top universities, including McGill and Queen's University. He has published over 500 papers, some of which are in Science and Nature, and journals that most of us science types only dream of publishing in. He's written and edited books that are definitive volumes for paleoenvironmental research and lake ecology research. His work is very highly cited. He is an editor and a good one, which is not an easy job. He lectures all over the world. He is constantly being invited to give plenary talks, and he has 6 honorary degrees. He has a very successful research lab with about 40 students, postdocs, visiting scientists at any given time. He's received numerous awards for his teaching, well-deserved awards, for his research, for his contributions to society, one of them being the Officer of the Order of Canada. The closest equivalent in the US would probably be the Presidential Medal of Freedom. There's a reason for this. There's a reason why he has all of these awards and all of these accomplishments. In fact, there's several reasons. I managed his research lab and was his editorial assistant for about 5 years before I decided to pursue a PhD. And there's some things about John that I know, that I have seen, that have contributed to his success. First, he is a hard worker. He's probably one of the hardest workers that I know. All of us in the lab would know when John was up in the morning because the emails would start. And that would just get the momentum going. And it would stay that way till night, probably after most of us had gone to bed. Maybe with a break in between for lunch. He's good about taking his lunch and a break for dinner. People do not get to where John is without giving it their all. And he has certainly done that. Second, he is in the pursuit of truth. He's not afraid to tell it. His work, his publications are based on facts, on hard data, on good solid data. John usually quotes scientists. I'm going to quote Dr. Seuss. I meant what I said, and I said what I meant. An elephant is faithful 100%. This is from Horton Hears a Who, from those of you who don't, or Horton Hatches the Egg. This epitomizes John. He thinks before he speaks and writes, and he sticks to his guns based on facts. No matter what people think, no matter who he may offend, he does not sugarcoat, which is one of the things I respect most about him. Next, he has high expectations for himself and for his students. He pushes them to do their best, which is why he has many who have gone on to become professors. He doesn't hold their hand. If you're doing research in John's lab, you always hear him say, "Work harder." And if they say, "I am working harder," he'll say, "Well, work longer." He instills that ethic in them that makes them successful, which is probably why most of them are very successful. Next, he cares. He cares about his family. He cares about his friends. He cares about his students. He cares about his research, and he cares about this planet that we live on. He's a true environmentalist, not an arm-waving, in-your-face environmentalist, but one that is not afraid to say what the data are telling him. He will not hold back. He truly believes that everyone has the right to know about the research that all of us are doing, not just his own research. He believes in a well-informed society and does the best to inform them with facts and in words that everyone can understand. So you may ask, why did I leave to do a PhD if his lab is so great? Because he inspired me to do research of my own. If I can be half the professor that he is, I will consider myself to be successful. He started as my boss, as a mentor, and is now someone I'm very proud to call a colleague and a friend. It is with great pleasure that I introduce to you today Dr. John P. Smol, the 41st Moon Distinguished Lecturer.
Well, thank you very much, and I'm delighted to be here. Thank you, Fawn, for that lovely introduction. Ooh, there's something back here. That lovely introduction. I thank you, everyone, from the West Texas Medical Associates and also from the university. We've had a wonderful visit here, meeting lots of excellent students and interesting faculty and excellent faculty. We're really having a wonderful time learning about what you're doing and trying to discuss a whole variety of important issues. I'm delighted to give the series of lectures. I've already given a few, and I'll be giving another one at 8 o'clock tonight on a somewhat different topic. I'll start off by some apologies. I'm noticing that my two lectures have some similar slides at the start, and that's because I know that some of you will be also here at 8 o'clock, so I apologize for that. But to get through the introduction, I have some of the similar slides between them. But I'll be talking about different issues to a certain extent, but in the environment, everything is interconnected. And what I was going to talk about today is canaries in the coal mine, polar regions as sentinels of climate change. And this is where I do a lot of my work, is up in the high Arctic. And I wanted to talk about how different ecosystems are changing, why they're changing, what's behind it, and why we should care about it. Should we really care about what happens in places like the Arctic? And my argument is yes, because it does affect us all. Now, before I get into some of the specific examples I wanted to discuss, I think probably most of you are aware that we're on a planet that has a lot of environmental issues. And as I'm sure many of you know, geologists tend to divide Earth history into different time periods, for example, the Holocene, the Pleistocene, and so on and so forth. Well, it's not quite an official designation yet, but probably in the next year or so, there's going to be a new era or new period in the geological timescale called the Anthropocene. And the Anthropocene is the period of human-dominated Earth's history. And this is because humans have become the dominant force on this planet. Humans move more soils now than natural processes do. Humans have, by their various technologies and different advancements, altered the chemistry of water, for example, by adding, for example, nutrients that cause algal blooms or contaminants. We've been altering our atmosphere by putting material into the atmosphere and things like greenhouse gases and different types of pollutants. So humans are the dominant force on the planet, and that's going to be recognized soon by geologists at a separate geological period. Now, where that line is going to be drawn is that really now the point of discussion. I suspect it's going to be 1945 or around 1945 for a variety of reasons, but that's really often where it's referred to as the Great Acceleration. After 1945, although humans were impacting the environment going back hundreds and even millennia, it's really since 1945 when things really started changing very, very quickly. So we live in a human-dominated planet, and this is causing major issues. Now, ideal in the environmental field, and I was just giving a talk, a lunchtime talk, and I use the analogy that in the environment, often environmental scientists usually come to a problem, an environment problem, almost like an ambulance to an accident scene, or perhaps a detective to a crime scene. You come after the fact. Usually, we only come and study an environmental problem after we have it. And that poses some serious questions. Just like in medical, using medical analogies, we often require a history to know, do we have a problem, and what caused the problems. So for example, when it comes to environmental issues, these are the typical questions we ask as environmental scientists. We want to know what were pre-disturbance conditions. Basically, what is natural? What was the environment like before humans were a significant factor? Because with most environmental issues, we have both natural causes and human-related causes. We can't do much about the natural forcing factors, but we can do something about those that are related to our activities. So we want to know what was the pre-disturbance condition. A good example I talked about in an earlier talk today was acid rain. I cut my teeth on acid rain in the 1980s, and one of the biggest issues then was, how acid were lakes before acid rain? And of course, no one had these measurements. So it requires this timed component. Or if you have algal blooms, greening of your lakes or ponds, is what I'm doing responsible? Or did we always have these greening lakes of ponds? No, what is the background condition? We might be seeing something in a monitoring record, but that's typically a very short record of monitoring. Most of our monitoring records of the environment are a few years long. Climate change might be an example. I don't think too many can deny something very strange is happening with the climate, but the argument is made, yes, but that's all part of some natural cycle. Well, I think I have data to show that that isn't the case. We understand how natural climate change has happened, and I think we have a very good handle on how much is related to human activities. Have conditions changed? How much? How fast? When? Why? Each of these questions we ask in ecology and environmental science has a time or a temporal component associated with it. And that is one of the biggest challenges we have. We don't have the monitoring data. People weren't measuring the environment for us in a way that we can use this directly in these environmental assessments. So my main theme here is the past matters. History is important. It's important in the medical field, and it's important in the environment field. Knowing the patient's history is a key component to a medical analysis. Knowing the environment's history is a key component to understanding environmental problems. And just to give you some idea of how serious our issues are with timescales, what I have here is from one of my textbooks. And what I did here is I went to the International Journal Environmental Monitoring and Assessment, and I asked the question in this international journal, how long are monitoring programs? And this is a journal dedicated to long-term monitoring programs. And it turns out about two-thirds, or over 60%, are less than 1 year in duration, and over 90% are less than 3 years in duration. Now, that's not to say a program, an environmental program of 3 years or less is not of any use. Of course it is. There's many questions you can answer. But if all your monitoring, if over 90% of your monitoring data is on timescales of 3 years or less, you're going to have trouble answering those questions that I posed in the previous slide. We need longer-term data. And it's not surprising most monitoring programs or so forth are less than 3 years of duration. If you apply to, for example, the National Science Foundation for a grant, the grants are typically 3 years or less. If you expect a PhD student to do his or her field research, usually you expect about three field seasons, so it's not that surprising. But 3 years is actually a very short time when it comes to some of the major environmental problems we're dealing with. So the problem is we try and push the history back into time, the historical record. And we do that in a variety of ways. One is we might not have direct measurements of, say, direct measurements of how big fish were in the past if we're working on lakes. I'm a lake biologist, so I work on lakes. But you may have, for example, other types of historical records. For example, diaries. A good example might be, I'll be talking about climate in this lecture. I'll be talking about pollution, other types of pollution in my evening lecture. But climates is a good example. We may not know the temperatures. I'll use a Canadian example. The Hudson's Bay Company. Hudson's Bay was a major fur trading organization in the 1600s, 1700s, based in England. And they sent proctors or people to trade with Canada's native peoples for furs, primarily beaver. And they'd send them over from the Hebrides and from northern Scotland, and they'd come to Canada. And they didn't measure the temperature. They didn't have thermometers, but they did write long flowing letters back to England, and they had diaries, and they say things like, the lake froze yesterday. Well, that has some climate information in it, or the river is thawed. That's all important climate information. So we grab the information wherever we can. There's also, especially working in northern Canada, what we refer to as traditional knowledge or traditional environmental or ecological knowledge. And although many of Canada's native peoples did not have things written down, they have a very strong oral tradition of talking. My great-grandfather used to fish in this lake, and my grandmother tells us that lake used to freeze in September in the past. This is not written down in a scientific way, but it's still pretty important information that we can't ignore. There's the whole field of modeling. I work with modelers. I'm not a modeler. I'm not really going to be talking about modeling here, but that's definitely a component of the work that we do in the environment. What I'm going to talk about is this third approach here, which I collectively refer to as natural archives. And again, all around us on this planet are different types of natural archives. The trees out there are a type of natural archive. In their tree rings, they're recording passively aspects of the environment of San Angelo. depending how wide the tree ring is, I'm sure all of you have cut down the tree and noticed that there's these circular annual things. Well, the depth, the thickness of the ring, the depth, the properties of the ring, all gives us some information on how the environment has changed. And all around us is different types. There's ocean ice cores in the Arctic and Antarctica and up mountains. I'm going to be talking about a specific type of natural archive. I work on lakes, and I'm going to be talking about lake sediments. So I'm a limnologist. The limnologist is sort of the inland water side of oceanography, or the lake side, or the lake and river side of oceanography. And I'm a paleolimnologist. I work on lake histories. And what we do in paleolimnology, just like they do in paleo-oceanography, in our case, we reconstruct lake and river histories using the information contained in lake sediments. And this includes physical, chemical, and biological information. So the overall process is remarkably simple. Lakes slowly fill with mud. The lake sediments or the lake muds are a history book or a memory of the lake and the ecosystem around it. 24 hours a day, 365 days of the year, mud is slowly accumulating at the bottom of a lake. In that mud is a remarkably clear record of what happened within the lake and outside lakes. The mud is coming first from outside the lake, or so-called the allochthonous material, things like pollen grains from the trees around us, aerially transported contaminants, soil particles. Slowly that's entering that history book, slowly layering at the bottom of a lake. I'm a limnologist. I'm usually more interested in what's happening in the lake itself, and there's a tremendous amount of material coming within the lake as well. Things like fossils of algae and vertebrates and animals and so on and so forth, or chemical precipitates. Slowly, day by day, year after year, these sediments are accumulating at the bottom of a lake. And it's a history book. And our job as paleolimnologists is to remove that history at the bottom of a lake and to interpret that information in a way that's meaningful to other scientists and the public at large. I'm not saying it's a perfect history of what happened in the lake and outside the lake, but it's a remarkably clear history. We have independent ways to find out how much mixing or how many problems have occurred, so we actually can do quite a lot in reconstructing what lived in the lake and what came from outside the lake as well. From that, we can reconstruct the missing data sets that the direct monitoring has not used. So in most lakes, just use a Canadian example, Canada's full of lakes. Most lakes in Canada can go back about 12,000 years since the time of the last ice age. And in most lakes, that would be about 4 meters of sediment, maybe 5 yards, 4 to 5 yards of sediment, and that would be a full 12,000-year history of that lake system. Some parts of the world, we didn't have ice age, and we go back millions of years, like Africa. I'm going to be talking mainly about the last 200 years or recent human impacts, so I'm often going to be only using the top, 50 centimeters, the top 2 feet or so of lake sediments, where the last couple of hundred years of lake history are stored. So since I'm going to be focusing on the recent past, I don't have to go back yard or meter after meter. What I'm going to be doing is reconstructing, just taking the top, say, half meter or the top 2 feet of sediment. For most lakes, that's about the last 200 or 300 years, and it captures the period of significant human impacts, at least in North America. And, of course, the surface sediments are very watery, very easily disrupted by coring and by other organisms. You have to be a little careful how you take those sediments. We take the sediments using these are the glue cores developed by John Glue in my lab. The sediment is extremely watery, but if you do it carefully, you can actually remove that history book without disturbing it. And I use it basically goes down as a tube, slowly going into the sediment. Then it's like putting your thumb on top of a straw and pulling it up. And as you can see, even though this is almost 100% water sediment, I don't know how well you see it, but you can even see the fine laminations. So that is a history of about the last 200 or 300 years of this lake contained in those sediments. Once we have the history book, the next stage, like pages in a book going back in time, the deeper I go, the older I get. And here I'm removing about a quarter centimeter at a time. And each of those slices I'm going back, it's about 2 or 3 years of lake history. So in that mud, every time I go back, I'm going back a few years of lake history. And in that mud is a tremendous amount of information from fossils and other types of organisms and other types of chemical precipitates and other types of residues we can use to interpret the lake history. Now, it's one thing to say I've got I'm saying 200 years, 300 years, 1,000 years. How do I know that? We have to somehow put pages in this book that we found. And to do that, we need to date the sediments. Now, if we're going back thousands of years, it's quite simple. We use radiocarbon or C14 dating. And I'm sure most of you, or all of you, are familiar with radiocarbon or C14 dating. It's the same thing archaeologists use with bones. That's good for like thousands of years, 4,000 years, 10,000 years, the long-term time scale. It's not the correct time scale for the last 100 or 200 years. It doesn't have the right half-life. But we use another isotope, lead-210, a naturally occurring isotope in the uranium series. And lead-210 doesn't have a half-life of 4,000 or 5,000 years like radiocarbon. Lead-210 has a half-life of 22 years. So by measuring how much of this isotope is left in the sediments, we can, instead of just putting that's 1 centimeter or 10 centimeters or so on, I can actually put dates on the side of the core. And here's a core I took in Ontario near where I live. The bottom of the core is from the 1840s. That's the 1940s. That's the 1980s. And it's not exactly the year 2000. It's not exactly the year 1981. But we can actually have some error bars, and we know approximately what our errors are. So we actually know where we are in the fossil record. So you have the fossils or the information, and you have the dating sequence. Now, you look at that core and you say, well, that just looks like a bunch of mud. And in fact, it is a bunch of mud. It is sediment. But in that sediment is a tremendous library of information. Now, I'm a biologist. I'm going to focus in this talk mainly on biological indicators. The talk this evening will talk much more about chemical indicators. But for biological indicators, really, it's two major types. One is morphological, and especially microfossils, things you can actually see with your eyes, bits and pieces of things that lived, more like an archaeologist, bits and pieces, except much smaller. Archaeologists looking at bones, we're looking at tiny exoskeletons, very high-resolution microscopes. But it's remarkable what leaves a record in the fossil record. And we can reconstruct by looking at fossils. A lot of my lab is based on taxonomy, looking at very detailed taxonomic changes. But not everything leaves a hard part. Things like you may have in some of your ponds and rivers, blue-green algae or cyanobacteria, this soft algae that are causing all these problems. Well, they don't actually leave a hard part, but they leave a chemical fossil or a biogeochemical fossil, things like fossil pigments or organic chemistry. My main focus here is that you can reconstruct almost anything in the lake sediment record. And so there's material coming from the atmosphere, things like carbon particles from carbon combustion, coal particles, so on. You can actually reconstruct things that what was burned, and you can do metals and other pollutions from industries, things like mercury, lead, DDT, PCBs. And I'm mainly going to be talking about these types of things in my evening lecture. You can tell how the land itself, the lake or the waterways, are intimately associated with the land because the land drains into the lake or the river. And we can reconstruct what happened on land. Things like pollen grains. I know some of you, myself included, has been sneezing the last few days in San Angelo. There's a lot of pollen in the air. As you probably know, all the plants out there produce different types of pollen. I can look down a microscope and tell you, at least to the genus level, of what plant that pollen is from. Since pollen is so well preserved in lake sediments, you can reconstruct how terrestrial vegetation has changed by looking at the pollen in the record. And you can, from this you can get climate change, all sorts of other things. So it's a very important component of that. Mineral particles, insect remains, all that comes in. Now, I'm a limnologist. I'm usually more interested in what's happening in the lake itself. And again, virtually everything in the lake is leaving some sort of record. Not everything, but a lot, you know, very important organisms. Things like algae, I'll be talking a lot about some of these algae, especially diatoms. Algae are the primary producers on the in our waterways. Just like we have terrestrial plants, when we get into the oceans and lakes and rivers, it's algae. It's a photosynthetic, microscopic, typically microscopic organisms. And foremost among these is a group of algae called the diatoms. I'll say a bit more about them in a minute. But diatoms is one of the main groups of algae we use as indicators. They're very good indicators. Then we have things like water fleas or cladostra. Unfortunately, again, the whole water flea doesn't preserve, but bits and pieces do. It's much like archaeology, but at a much smaller scale. And experts can look at these bits and pieces and say, that's part of a Daphnia magna, or that's part of, you know, a holopedium, and so on and so forth. And aquatic insects also, they leave good fossils that we can use. But I'm going to talk a bit about diatoms. The focus on this talk will be one group because of interest in time. I'm going to focus on one major group of algae that are really the workhorse of many of these studies, and that's the diatoms. The diatoms are a group of algae, these tiny microscopic plant-like organisms. They're extremely abundant. There's various estimates, but some estimates are about one-third of the production on this planet comes from these tiny diatoms. They're typically the dominant form of primary plant-like material in the oceans, often the dominant in lakes and rivers as well. Wherever there's liquid water, we usually find diatoms. They're an extremely abundant group of organisms on this planet. They're also extremely diverse. There's tens of thousands of species. So they're an extremely successful group of organisms. And they're excellent environmental indicators. And by that I mean some species live only in acid water. Some live only in alkaline water. Some live only in salty water. Some live only in fresh water. Some live only in cold water or warm water, shallow water, deep water. And I'm saying that in a very qualitative, simple way here, but a large part of what my lab has been doing is quantifying those relationships. And we use biology to reconstruct environment all the time. If I showed you a picture of a polar bear, you'd know right away something about the environment. You know it's cold, because polar bears are in cold environments. You know you're in the Arctic, not the Antarctic, because polar bears are only in the Arctic. You'd know you're near the ocean, because 98% of the diet of a polar bear is ring seal. You'd know quite a lot if I showed you a polar bear. If I showed you a camel, you'd know quite a lot if I did that. Well, the same thing with each of these species. A lot of what my lab does is cataloging in great detail of where they live, and we do that in a very precise quantitative numerical way that we can actually calibrate the fossil. So by knowing 10% of this and 15% of that and 12% of that and 5% of that means the pH of the lake was about 7.2 and that, you know, the lake was ice-covered 11 months of the year. We can actually do that to a fair amount of precision. And importantly, from a paleo perspective, their cell walls are made of glass or silica. And the cell walls are species-specific. By looking at that glass cell wall, because it's glass, it's extremely well-preserved in lake sediments. It's almost indestructible. And because each species has a very different type of cell wall, the fossils are species-specific, or we can identify the species and therefore reconstruct the environment. So here's just a figure of some common diatoms. I think they're quite remarkable. These are in your water that you're drinking. You're not going to choke on them. These are magnified about several thousand times here. But I think they're quite remarkable looking. This cyclotella, for example, is found in very pure, clean water, for example. This olacosaur is somewhat more productive waters. This cymbella lives in the shallow waters attached to plants. Different species have very specific ecological requirements, and because we know those, we can use the fossils to reconstruct how the environment has changed in the past. So that's the basic assumption. So it's pretty well a straightforward process. You can pick your study lake. You can take the sediment core. You can section it and date it like I did. You look at the fossils, a very long step here at the microscope, and then you analyze the data. So it's a fairly straightforward process. Now, there's many, many things you can do with paleolimnology. As Fawn said, there's over 40 people in our lab at Queen's University, and here are some of the things my lab is working on right now. Algal blooms, anoxia, groundwater quality, acid rain, fire history. What I'm going to focus on for this talk is climate change. And I'm going to take climate change, and I'm going to also talk about climate change and why that's a particular problem. When we think of climate, we tend to think of temperature data or meteorological data. But there are some real problems that we have in environmental sciences with direct monitoring, as I said earlier. We don't have the long time frames. And when it comes to meteorological data, we have some real serious problems. Even though meteorological data is probably the best of all the environmental data we still have relatively short time series. Most monitoring of climate started when a city was developed. So in North America, there are a few cases of climate data going back 300 years, I think for Boston, for New York, Charleston, South Carolina, for example, but you can put them on one hand, the records going back more than about 200 years. Most records of climate, where we have them, goes back 100, 120 years. And for some areas, it's far less. In the Arctic, it's only like 50 or 60 years where we have it. The other problem is variable standards. People may have monitored climate in different ways going back in the past, and we're talking only about 1 or 2 degrees centigrade, so a big change. And when we do have long-term records, they're almost all from big cities. They're from big cities from the northeastern United States, and they're big cities in Western Europe. Almost all our data is from these big cities, so it's very geographically constrained. And then finally, where it is available, it's from big cities. And people have argued that because it's from big cities, any of the heating you're showing is just because of the city itself generating its own heat. So there's some real problems of using meteorological data. And here's really where the problem comes in. You probably don't recognize these two gentlemen, but you recognize their names. And there it is. Both Fahrenheit and Celsius developed their temperature scales back in the 1700s. And so really, we can't really get data going back any farther than that. So we need long-term or paleoclimate data. We need it to determine natural modes of climate change. We need to extend that monitoring window back in time. We want to determine the intensity and frequency of extreme events like hurricanes. And of course, it's very important for model development and evaluation. So there's a real need now to reconstruct climate change going back in time. Now, so just a brief introduction to what I'm going to say about climate. I think all are familiar with this, but here's where we live, planet Earth. And I think two things, you know, if alien beings ever came and saw planet Earth, they wouldn't have called it Earth, they call it water, because it's mostly water. And water, of course, is a very important component of the system, and that's what I'm going to be talking about today. But also, the atmosphere around our planet is very important. It's a very thin film. If you have a globe sitting on your desk, the depth of our atmosphere is about the depth of the shellac or the varnish on that globe. So it isn't a very thick atmosphere, but very important. It's very important in a variety of things, including the fact that we're here as people, but also in temperature regulation. And one of the critical factors in it is how much greenhouse gases we have in the atmosphere. And I think most of you are quite familiar with this, but carbon goes through a cycle, and a cycle that's very well understood, that basically carbon dioxide going out from natural sources, from like decay, from volcanoes and things like that, as well as from fossil fuel burning. And then it's coming back, it's taken up by plants, by photosynthesis, and it goes through what for many, many, many years was a very well-constrained cycle that we can show in the paleo record. One thing we started doing in an accelerated way a few hundred years ago, and especially in the last 50 years, though, is we were taking carbon that was long buried in coal and oil and burning it in a much faster rate. So this is carbon that was buried millions and millions of years ago, and now we're releasing it into the atmosphere. And that's what's changing the carbon cycle due to human impacts. And the reason why we know this is important is, well, it is changing the temperature and the climate of the planet. Of course, the ultimate source of energy is the sun, as it always has been on the planet. Incoming energy comes in. Some of it along the way gets reflected by clouds and dust, but a lot of it hits the Earth, and then it goes out as long-wave radiation, and it's been doing that for a very long period of time. Once we started changing the opacity, if you like, of our atmosphere by increasing greenhouse gases, some of that, more and more of that energy was being trapped, and that's where the problem comes. We're heating the planet in a disproportionate way due to this increase in greenhouse gases. It's a fairly well understood process. So why is that important? Well, I think it's important for a wide variety of reasons, but I'm going to take you to a place where it's really important. It's being shown to be important first. It's a nice hot Texas day here. And this is the changes in temperature since 1958 to 2008. So it's a 50-year change in temperature. And this is what I mean by polar amplification. You hear about polar or Arctic amplification. It means the Arctic regions or the Antarctic regions are changing typically the fastest and doing so to the greatest degree. And this shows it here. This is just in the last 50 years of how much faster warming has happened in the northern and to some extent the southern regions than compared to other large parts of the world. And as we often refer to, in the title of my talk, the miners' Canaries, our planet is on, we often refer to the Arctic regions as the miners' Canaries, just like the coal miners used to go and bring canaries into the coal mine. They were like the early warning indicators. They were maybe like the early smoke detectors, if you like. They'd bring down canaries into the coal mine, and when sulfide gas was getting high, the canaries would first get agitated and then die. And that's when the miners knew, get out of the mine because the mine is about to blow up. We often refer to the Arctic as the miners' Canaries because they're first to show signs of environmental change, and they do so to the greatest degree, and I'll talk about that right here as to why that is. There's many reasons why polar regions are so sensitive, but one of the most important ones has to do with albedo or reflectivity. And again, I think many of you are quite familiar with this, but I use an analogy as a fairly hot, or at least for me, a fairly hot, I think it gets hotter here, a fairly hot, said Angelo day out there. you can go out on the parking lot and put your hand on a white car and a black car side by side. The white car may be hot, but the black car is hotter. And that's because the black car is absorbing heat. It has low albedo or low reflectivity. The white car is acting much more like a mirror and is reflecting heat. And that's why we often wear whiter clothes, and when it's hot in summer, we want to reflect the heat. We don't want to heat up. Same thing as you might be at a pool on a very hot August day, and you see a white chair and a black chair. You might want to sit on the white chair just so you don't burn yourself so badly. Well, the Arctic in its natural state is like the white car, snow and ice. However, with warming, you're getting rid of some of that snow and ice. You're exposing more and more of the dark ground underneath. You're getting more like the black car, which heats up more, which then melts more snow and ice, which heats up more. And you can see how, I don't want to say snowball effect, but basically snowball effect. It's a positive feedback system where things, you start it in one direction, it just gets worse and worse and worse. And that's one of the main reasons why Arctic regions are so sensitive. And to show this as an example of a positive feedback, as temperatures go down, snow and ice cover goes up, albedo goes up, which again decreases temperature. But on the other hand, if you increase temperature, you decrease snow and ice cover, you decrease the whiteness or the reflectivity, and so temperatures go up. And that's why it's such a serious issue in Arctic regions. Another reason we go to the Arctic, it's a relatively clean page. Now, it's not a completely clean page. I'm talking this evening at 8 o'clock about Arctic pollution. It's not a completely. But you don't have railroads. You don't have highways. You don't have agriculture. There's a lot of things that complicate the picture if I did the same type of studies initially in places like Texas or in Ontario where I live. So you try and go to a relatively clean page. The other thing about the Arctic, it's a beautiful place. If you have a chance, I suggest you go there. I've been going there for over 30 years. The Arctic is full of lakes and ponds. Everywhere I see a lake and pond, I think there's a history book just waiting for us to explore. So I'm going to take you where we did the initial work. I started some of this work in 1983. I was very young, I want to point out. But I've been working in the Arctic for over 30 years. And one part of the Arctic, I have data going back since 1983. So I'm going to use that as my main example, and I'll come back to it at the end of this talk. Some very controversial work we did in the 1990s, now very widely accepted, but very controversial at the time. And I'm going to take you, this is where I live here in Kingston, Ontario, right here on Lake Ontario, just north of Syracuse. Canada, as I'm sure you know, is a big country. It's about 6 time zones from one end to the other. It's about as wide, about as tall north and south as it is east to west. It's the second largest country in the world, and it's a hard place to get to do some of this work. And that's one of the reasons we don't have that much information from there. And certainly in 1983, it was really terra incognita, first people there. But now it's gotten much easier to do this work. I have to get myself up to Ottawa, with the capital. It's only a 2-hour drive. Then every day you can take a jet now to Iqaluit, the capital of Nunavut, one of the main Arctic territories. It's about a 3.5-hour jet ride. A 727 or a 737 does it. Very easy now to get there. Then you cool your heels in Iqaluit a bit. Then you take a much smaller plane, and that takes about 6 hours, and you get as far as Resolute Bay, which is about latitude 74, I think, 75, in that area. And then on a much smaller plane, then you leave on an even much smaller plane with skis on it, and you go another 3 or 4 hours, and this time you land typically on sea ice, because there's no airports anymore, and you land on sea ice. Then you go by helicopter, and then you walk. So the point being, it's not the easiest place to do field work, but it's isolated and extremely sensitive. And the first time I had an opportunity to go there was in 1983, and it's become a key focus for some of this climate change work. A highly sensitive area. We're about 80 degrees north latitude, 24-hour daylight in summer. You can't tell the difference from midnight and noon. We're that close to the North Pole, but also very sensitive because it's high polar, and we're going to look at some ponds. And one thing I saw about the place, it was full of lakes and ponds. This is late August. I know it's late August. That's Greenland in the background. It's only 55 kilometers away. That's the ice cap over there. This is on Ellesmere Island, Cape Kershaw. All these ponds I saw, and I know this is late August because the sea ice has melted. Still there's sea ice there, but the only time the sea ice melts is late August, early September, and by October it's freezing up again. There's snow on the ground all year round. At least there used to be. It's much less snow now. All these lakes and ponds, this seemed like an excellent place to study Arctic lakes and ponds that have not been studied before and to use them as an environmental history. And going back to my PhD thesis, I quickly realized that the dominant factor that's going to drive lakes in this part of the world is the amount of ice cover. I could go in a slightly warmer year and there'd be a lot less ice. I'd go in a colder summer and there'd be a lot more ice. And so this is the same lake under three climate scenarios. There is a cold year, a medium year, and a warm year. It's the same lake, the same lake water, but this is completely different ecosystem if you're living in that lake. Here in midsummer, the ice never leaves. So you've got this blanket of several meters of ice and snow. And remember, diatoms are algae, they're photosynthetic, they need light. So a large part of the lake is not available for much photosynthetic or algal growth. As the lake warms, more and more of the lake becomes open. So the amount of lake ice cover is a very good thermometer. And since this is changing the ecological characteristics of the lake, by looking at the fossils, we can reconstruct how much lake and ice cover was there, from which we can reconstruct climate. And remember, there's no climate data up here of any consequence, and yet it was such an important area. Now, these are the types of graphs we produce. I'm only going to show you a few because I know they're impossible to see, but I think you can see the magnitude of changes. Here's the first paper we published in International Journal Science, a major journal, in 1994. We decided to take, we spent 10 years studying the lakes and ponds, then I said it's time to go and see how they changed over time. We were absolutely stunned by what we saw. These are the fossils. For thousands of, this lake goes back about 4,000 years. For thousands of years, it was relatively constant fossils. I'm not going to give you the names because I know it's not easy to see. But for thousands of years, we had diatoms, organisms that we know can thrive even under extensive ice cover. Then in the late 1800s, early 1900s, we have 100% change in fossils. It's essentially 100%, a complete shift. It's like, you know, it's very hard to put in terrestrial terms. It's like going from a grassland to trees. That's how impressive that change is ecologically. Here's one lake that goes back 4,000 years. We did this on many lakes. I'll show you two. Here's another one. This one goes back 8,000 years. Again, for thousands of years, these cold water, ice-loving fossils, then the lake, the pond, clearly in our view, is opening up. Far, far less ice cover over the last century. What we're seeing and what we could predict based on our understanding is that you, with warmer conditions, you're going to have less ice cover, a longer growing season, more open water plankton, more mosses, more diversity, more nutrients, more production, higher pH, higher conductivity. Everything we see in the fossils is on this right-hand side of the table. We concluded back in 1994 that what we were seeing after thousands of years of relative stability, not total stability, we saw some climate changes, natural climate changes, we saw a remarkable change that we linked to changing ice cover. We argued this was the first signs of human-induced warming in this environment. What we were saying is that for thousands of years, we had the environment of these rocks, these bare rocks with these really hardy, cold water diatoms like the small fragile area species. It got sufficiently open water that we had mosses. We had these far more complex assemblages that we could only, the only way we could explain them with far less ice cover. Well, you publish a paper in Science. It's a major journal. You feel pretty good. You know, you feel like you've done something. You're quite proud of yourself. This is before even email was quite common. We felt good for about a week or so. About a week later, we start getting the letters and the phone calls saying, how could you say this? This is ridiculous. Remember, it's an anachronism. It's now 2017. In the early 1990s, greenhouse warming was not really much on the radar screen. Certainly, it was something that was thought to happen soon in the future or in the future. We were saying in these sensitive areas, it's already been happening over the last century. And so we suddenly concluded the only one who seemed to believe this paper was the editor of Science and the three external reviewers. But a lot of people started doing this type of work across the circumpolar Arctic. And criticism, as I said to the class, to the students at the dinner last night, criticism is the energy or the oxygen that drives science forward. So we were heavily criticized. People did not believe what we did. But so we said, okay, and people started doing these types of studies in northern Finland, in Russia, in the Russian Arctic, in Alaska, in Greenland. And we said, if these changes are really linked to climate variables, then we should see similar changes on a global scale. And this brings me back to going to a scientific conference in Finland where a lot of these other scientists were, and they were starting to show their data, and this is, well, it looks like they're showing exactly what Marianne Douglas and I showed in the high Arctic. And so what we did is we tried to bring together everyone who used the same techniques in the Arctic for this type of study and put them together and try and see, do we see the same patterns across the globe? We published this paper in 2005, the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, and it has 26 co-authors, and I'm thinking about writing a paper with 26 co-authors, but that's another story. But we had over 50 profiles all across the circumpolar Arctic. And I'm not going to show you 50 profiles. I'm just going to show you exactly as predicted what happened. So I'll just show a few classic ones. So in the Canadian High Arctic, you expect the biggest changes, the most sensitive part of the world. Sure enough, I showed you that already. Those are the warm water species. I showed you that core. Here's one from the Western Canadian Arctic. Canada, same thing. As you go farther south, you'd expect less and less dramatic changes. Here's from Baffin Island. Again, still big changes, but exactly as predicted. Here is on the mainland, again, still changes, but less and less happening a little later. You go to the European Arctic, for example, Svalbard and Spitsbergen, virtually identical changes to what we have in the Canadian Arctic. You go farther south in Lapland or Russia, again, exactly as predicted. And you can graph this, and it comes out exactly what you would predict by forcing from greenhouse gas warming. There were, however, we had, I think, 16 cores from northern Quebec, Labrador, Hudson's Bay area. Up until the mid-1990s, one part of the Arctic was not warming yet. And this was the this part of Canada and around into Hudson's Bay. And the reason for this, I'm not an oceanographer, but oceanographers had good reasons for this. It had to do with the ice, the way the ice was moving. And they say one part of the Arctic was still protected from global warming because it was like having big ice cubes still there of the ice coming from Greenland, coming down the Labrador Current. Also, Hudson's Bay was kept from warming quickly yet because Hudson's Bay chokes ice because of its shape, and it was choked with ice for a long period of time. However, this was important because we had 16 cores that were taken before 1995, and this was our control area. Every single one of those 16 cores were pretty well straight lines. We didn't have these enormous changes. So this is a way of saying it wasn't something else. It wasn't like some pollution coming from the atmosphere. We have 16 cores. The one place that hadn't warmed up until that time came out as straight lines. Okay, but I said it didn't warm until the late 1990s. What's happened since then? So that would be the next prediction. If Arctic regions had only recently warmed, say in the mid-1990s, then we should be able to now go back to those same lakes, take the same cores, and we should see the same type of changes happening in the post-1995 sediments. That's exactly what we did, and that's exactly what we found. I'll take you now to another, was a relatively high-profile paper, the Proceedings of the Royal Society. We went to the Hudson's Bay lowlands. We just published this a few years ago. And I'm going to take you, as I said, the Hudson's Bay area was very slow to warm because ice was choked in sort of like this block. It was like a big water bottle of ice stuck in the Hudson's Bay area. However, in the mid-1990s, we know from the instrumental record, that changed. The ice started to double. All that started happening in the 90s. As you probably know, the polar bears were in big trouble in the 1990s. This is the actual temperature data for Hudson's Bay. We go back to the 1940s, and you can see this big break point happening in the early to mid-1990s. Hudson's Bay, the temperature record shows that. We predicted that if we went back and cored those lakes, we should see those remarkable changes, not happening in the early 1900s, but only in the last 15 years. Well, that's exactly what we found. We did many cores. We published it. I'll just show you two profiles here. Here's North Raft Lake. Again, the big changes all happening around 1995. Here's another one, Aquatuck. Again, the big changes happening right when the warming started increasing. We have many cores showing that. It was like a nice little test to challenge our assumptions. In fact, this maybe shows it better. This is a warm water diatom. This is cyclotella. It needs open water. This is the actual temperature that was measured in the area. You can see how nicely the warm water diatom in the fossil record is matching the temperature record. Here's another one. This is another warm water diatom. You can see in red is the temperature readings, and in blue, you can see how the diatoms. We do actually have a paleothermometer that we can now use to show what these effects have been. So we look for the miner's canaries, and as maybe the miner's canary is, in fact, these diatoms, this is an area where we don't have trees to do more traditional types of reconstructions. We don't have the temperature data, so we can actually use these approaches. I'm just going to conclude with a few slides here. I said I started my work 1983 in Cape Herschel. I'm going to come back to Cape Herschel, what it is like now. Back when we published our paper in 1994, we said this was due to greenhouse gas warming. We also started saying that if this warming continues, These ponds, which we know from the paleo record, were permanent water bodies since the Ice Age. We know they've been there. We said, if it keeps warming, these ponds eventually are going to disappear, evaporate away. We never thought we'd see it in our lifetime, but we never predicted how fast climate warming would have started over the last century. So based on our ability to show that these Cape Herschel ponds, paleo data I just showed you, we were able to show that these Cape Herschel ponds have been permanent water bodies since about the Ice Age for thousands of years. We also showed from the paleo data I just showed you that they started to change dramatically over the last century or so, all consistent with climate warming. What's happened to these ponds over the last decade, the warmest decade on record in this Arctic? And this is what we're calling the final ecological threshold. Again, a paper published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences of the United States, again, quite a prestigious journal. And what it comes down to, I'm going to show you some photographs going back to history. Some of these are our main study sites. Some of these are even before I was there. I was there in 1983. A colleague of mine, a geologist, was a glaciologist. He happened to be at Cape Herschel in July 1979. He was actually taking pictures of the glacier back here. But this is one of our main study ponds, Camp Pond. Camp Pond, maybe not even the size of this room, a small pond. Is one of the ones we studied, one of the ones I showed you, it was in the paper, I didn't show you actually, there's many cores, so I only showed you a couple. But it also changed quite dramatically over the last century. This is what Camp Pond looks like, in this case 1987. This is the end of the year. You see by August, the winter snow has already come back, we're quite far north. And you can still see a healthy pond in the end of August in 1987. There's a younger, probably thinner John Smol sampling the pond. But you've had the whole summer of 24-hour daylight and still, of heat. And this should be the pond at this stage should be the lowest level you'd expect because of evaporation. Still a healthy pond. I should tell you all these ponds, before I go further, are excavated in granite. These are not thermokarst ponds. They're not draining from the bottom. They're like little swimming pools. They're like bathtubs. They're excavated in granite, so they don't situation. This is what they're not draining this way. It's an evaporation. They look like now in mid-July. That pond has been there for thousands of years. We know that. We had predicted they would eventually dry up. We never dreamed we'd see them in our lifetime. They have been drying up consistently every year we've been there by around mid-July. That is what's left of that pond that's been there for a thousand years. I took this photograph. This is the first in 2006. It's about 2 a.m. It's a 24-hour daylight, so it could easily be 2 p.m., but it's about 2 a.m., and I watched that pond that has been there for thousands of years. I watched it slowly evaporate away. What was left at 2 a.m. was this puddle, a puddle maybe twice the size of this desk. What I have here is my hand, and I have a piece of paper. What you have swimming around are all the little animals, all the little invertebrates that lived in that pond have now been concentrated to this little puddle. About an hour later, it had dried up totally. That's just dried up totally. It had been there for thousands of years. Small pond, slightly smaller than this room. What about the big sites? Cape Herschel Lagoon. Here's a picture of it in 1987. It's about the size of a football field, a sizable pond for that part of the world. This is what it looks like by July. These ponds are simply disappearing, and this is happening throughout large parts of the Arctic. They're simply evaporating away. What about the big lakes? Well, the big lakes still have water in them because they have a lot more water capacity. But the lake used to come right up here. This used to be a lush moss bank. Look how that's all exposed now. Now, mosses are photosynthetic. They take in carbon dioxide. They're part of our ecosystem services, removing carbon dioxide gas. These mosses are now exposed, dead, decomposing. Now they're releasing carbon dioxide. This has become how serious this is. This is when we talk about positive feedbacks. What used to be a greenhouse gas sink is now a source. And that's why we're so worried how things will start happening so quickly. Just since the 1980s, just since I've been there, we've seen the ponds disappear, start disappearing. We've seen temperatures going up. We've seen ice cover going down. We've seen evaporation increasing. We've seen water levels going down. And we know it's evaporation because I've been there since 1983, and I've been measuring how salty the water is. And I've been showing each year the water is getting saltier and saltier and saltier. And that's because of evaporation. It's quite simple. It's a simple thing as if you had a pot of soup on the stove and you took the lid off and you put it on low heat. That's basically what the ponds are like. Two things will happen to your soup. One, the soup level will go down as it evaporates. That's exactly what the ponds are doing. They're disappearing. If you keep tasting your soup, it gets saltier and saltier and saltier. That's because the water is evaporating away and the salts are left behind. That's exactly what's been happening here. As the evaporation has been increasing, the lakes have been decreasing, and the salinity has been increasing. I'll show this on a graph, which maybe is a little hard to see, but there's lots of data behind this. This is salt from this. I can't do it. I have 43 ponds or 38 ponds. I can't show you all 38 because about 20 are gone by the time I'm there. So the remaining 20 or so I can show you. This is what the salt levels were like in July in the 19 was like in the last decade in the 1980s. This is what the salt level in the 80s. If the pond comes on the one-to-one line, it means salinity has not changed. As you can see, every single pond but one, pond 32, has increased in salinity or increased in evaporation since the 1980s. The one pond that hasn't, pond 32, was the one pond we predicted a priori would not increase. Pond 32 is the only pond that has two streams coming in from the melting snow and ice on the two plateaus. So that one's constantly being replenished by fresh water. The ponds that aren't being replenished have all increased in salinity since then, even though precipitation has been increasing. So evaporation has overpowered precipitation. We have more evaporation than even the precipitation coming down. So it just shows you how rapidly this environment is changing. I showed you the ponds. What's even worse are the wetlands. People talk about wetlands. This is what the wetlands looked like in 1987. This is what they look like in July 2006. The wetlands are dry, and you can actually put a light to them and they start burning. Again, greenhouse gas sinks, becoming greenhouse gas sources. So just in my lifetime, we have crossed serious ecological thresholds. The temporary ponds are now completely dry land. They're covered by plants, completely dry land. The permanent ponds are now temporary ponds. Many of them are dry by July. The bigger lake ponds are shallower with exposed shoreline and all the associated physical, chemical, and biological changes happening in them. So we're crossing very serious ecological thresholds. And we're only at the front end of the problem. And this is what worries me more is these projections that we see into the future. I mean, I don't want to look at some of these diagrams, but this is, you know, projections by 2090 and so forth. We're only at the the thin edge of the wedge of what's actually happening. And I always loved this cartoon. It was sent to me by a colleague. One of his students had drawn it. But here they're bailing away, and I'm sure glad the hole isn't at our end. And I mean, I talk to a lot of people about the Arctic, and the Arctic seems so far away and so distant and so exotic, but we only have one planet, and what happens in the Arctic affects us all. First of all, what's happening in the Arctic is what's going to be happening in other parts of the world soon, because it happens first in the Arctic. We have very good reasons to know why that is. Secondly, we shouldn't fool ourselves. What happens in the Arctic affects us all in many other ways, not least of which is land-based ice, like from Greenland and Antarctica. Land-based ice that starts melting is raising sea levels, which is going to start flooding different parts of the world. And we already see that happen. We already know the sea levels are rising. Extreme weather is increasing. The string goes on and on. So although we might think it's not really our problem, we are only on planet Earth is only one boat, and we're all in the same boat. And so I think it's time we have to start dealing with some of these issues. So I hope from these first examples, you agree with me that the past is important, the past matters. And I think, although most people think of environmental research on hours, days, seasons, and most people thought of paleoecology thousands of years or centuries, some of these new methodologies, we can actually dovetail the true approaches. And that's really where a lot of the answers lay hidden. So thank you very much for your time. And 3 o'clock, right on time. Thank you very much. I'm happy to take questions if there are any, or comments or criticisms. Criticism is the oxygen that drives science. If I can see, I have a funny lights here. I don't know if I see ahead. Yeah. it depends which politicians I talked to. I think it was the data were respected by, I think at least the Canadian politicians I've talked to believe the data, but are mainly disagreeing on policy of what to do about it. I think there has been a shift. I'm talking about now. Maybe 10 years ago, I would have had real pushback just on the scientific data. But, you know, there's getting far, far less pushback on the science itself. it's becoming now, it's moving into the policy arena of what to do about it, and there's very diverse views of what to do there. And that's really where the political spectrum, I think, is coming to. So I think it's very important, as I say, to keep politicians, policymakers, the public at large informed on what we do. By and large, the public paid for this research, and they have a right to know what it shows and what its consequences are. My job, I think, as a scientist, is to show the science. I am quite aware that science is not the entire policy pie. You know, I've talked to enough politicians, and I cut my teeth on acid rain. Science isn't going to be the only part of the decision-making process, but I think it should be a bigger part of the process because it's largely being ignored in many important decisions. Yes, well, I think we have to curb greenhouse gases. And that goes to everybody. You know, I mean, it's easy for me, and it's very easy for me to say, well, the politicians just don't listen to me. There's nothing we can do. But in reality, there's a lot we can do. We're in a democracy. We're both in democracies. The citizens have a lot of power. I think we have power of our wallet. We can decide where we spend money, and a lot of people listen to where you spend money, and you can start spending your money far more importantly in areas where there is progressive action on things like cutting greenhouse gases. We can do our actions very, very clearly. We don't need to be using as much greenhouse gases as we do, and that some of that is some life choices. Some of that is keeping the house maybe a little warmer in summer, a little cooler in winter, maybe starting to use getting public transportation, better electrifying our systems, the type of fuel we use to have electricity and so forth. And we live in a democracy, the power of the vote. Politicians will listen to our wishes if they believe it's our wishes. And part of the problem with environmental work is that people often are sort of sympathetic to the environment, but only to a point, and the economy very quickly takes it over, which I understand. People are thinking of their whether they're thinking of their pensions or they're thinking of, I have to make the mortgage payment, don't tell me what I have to do in 30 years. I'm talking about a long-term problem, and it's very hard for people with short-term issues, and I understand short-term issues very well. It's a problem. We have to stop talking about the environment as a cost. Like we talk about education as a cost, and politics is the cost of education. How about the investment of education? It's not really a cost. To me, the environment is not a cost. Stop telling me how much it costs to fix the problem, telling me how much it costs not to fix the problem. And that is really a major issue that we don't do much of. It's very easy to put off something that seems decades away, but the longer we wait, we're losing options. We're going to need all the options we have. It's a serious problem. That's why we need research, too. I mean, we're going to need find. It's happening, so we have to start getting ready for it. And we're not very good at that. You know, we're very good at what's happening tomorrow, but not so much what's going to happen in 10 years. And, you know, frankly, someone of my age with the gray hair, I'm seeing some effects of it, but I'm probably going to make it. But to be honest, some of the younger people, and certainly your children and grandchildren, are going to have real serious problems. And I think that's the legacy, you know, people of my generation shouldn't have. So it's time to start making changes. Yeah. It's somewhat correct. There was legislation brought in by, it came in 1990, George Bush Sr. Signed the amendment to the act, and that greatly limited the amount of sulfur dioxide could be released by industry. It started in a graded system, and there were penalties for not doing it. So in a way, it's a tax. There was financial cost of not doing it. And to some extent, you could also trade to some extent. And then they signed a joint agreement with Canada, with Brian Mulroney the year after, and so then it was an international treaty on, and so we have the same type of controls. And so basically it came down to a law that you can no longer, and it was graded, you know, some time to do it, because there was technology to clean acid rain, but it cost money. It was a money issue. So now it said, no, now you got to spend the money. And, companies didn't go bankrupt, you know. When I was dealing with acid rain, I heard the similar arguments I hear with climate change. I heard arguments that Well, you know, first of all, it's all a communist plot. You know, it's because the communists aren't going to do this. Is the time of there was the Soviet Union. Well, and if we do this, you know, we'll lose to the Soviet. Well, what happened in, you know, 1990? The Soviet Union went bankrupt, basically, and the United States had some of the strongest economy in the world during the period of this period. And really, I didn't see where the companies went bankrupt or anything. I mean, they survived, and they did well. They found alternate ways and often cheaper ways. And many of those, you know, but some of the industries could not survive. I mean, you know, because I don't want to use the analogy, but there was probably some pretty good buggy whip companies too, you know, and I mean, things do change. Some industries just can't go on, but, you know, the general economy went on, and I'm a big believer. I grew up in a very, let's say, non-rich environment. I grew up poor. And I mean, I'm very, very sensitive to the social impact of some of the things I say. I mean, people have jobs, and some jobs may be disappearing. I'm not insensitive to that. But at a certain point, we have to also look at the other problems that are coming. Sure, yeah. There's several. I could try and send them to you on email. There's several. If I can get your email address, I'll try and the various techniques. And there's been studies done on the cost of the remediation and how much. Frankly, if you look at the bigger picture, just in human health, how much was saved in human health? Just one example: asthma. The number of days lost from work from asthma from sulfur dioxide, which is which was part of acid rain. How much days were not lost because emissions went down, let alone tourism industry and the Adirondacks and things like that. But I'm happy to send you some of those documents when I have to be in Canada to find them. I'm fairly easy to find too if you send me an email. If you Google John Smol, don't believe everything you read. Some people don't find me too popular, but most of it's positive. Thank you. I'm easy to find. Yeah, John Smol at Queen's University. Yeah.
Is there a question? Oh, yes, sir. Yeah, it's hard to see with these lights.
Is do I find anything in the surface sediments we don't find in other time periods? And there's definitely some when it comes to pollution. Some pollutants were only invented in the last century. I'll be showing one example this evening on DDT, which was a major insecticide, used to be used in the United States and Canada, all around the world up until about 1977 or thereabouts. 1970s ended earlier, was banned in the mid-1970s. Some of these pollutants were only invented like 1921, 1931. So we only see those after that. And we certainly see increases in certain types of pollutants. For example, I'll show an example of arsenic from a mine, very low arsenic. And then once the mine is there, it goes up, 1,000 times or something. We show the same type of work in the oil sands in Alberta. I was talking a little bit about that earlier. There's big concern. You can use this almost a forensic tool. Because sometimes we don't know what the problem is. And I was working in the oil sands or the tar sands of Alberta, which I'm sure many of you are somewhat familiar with, third largest oil deposit in the world. It has some environmental problems. And my argument was, I'm not saying shut down the oil sands, but we have to address these environmental problems. And one of the issues that was often said was, yes, the pollution levels in the oil sands region is higher than normal, let's say, but it's always been like that because the oil sands material is so close to the surface. Well, that was an easy thing to say, and the only way you could prove against that is to find out what was the pollution in the 1950s, 1940s, before the oil sands operation started in 1968. Well, no one was measuring the water 1940s, 1930s in the middle of the boreal forest of Alberta. Well, our techniques can do that. We went and took sediment cores, and we looked at these different pollutants that we think is associated with the oil sands. And sure enough, we could show, again published in the Proceedings of the National Academy,
a marked increase, exact lockstep with the oil sands operation. You can see like polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons increasing in lockstep with the oil sands production. So we could show that it wasn't all natural, and they were releasing some of this in the processes. And I think that's the first step. The first step is to identify you have a problem and then deal with it. And there are ways of dealing with a lot of these problems. But I get a little discouraged is why do we always have to prove the problem? Shouldn't there be a bit more onus on the front end to take a more cautious approach and just assume there might be a problem and then prove there isn't one? But it's always the other way around. So you're almost always playing catch up. And we keep releasing new things every year, so it's hard. Yes, sir. Certainly I go to China quite a bit because partly any problem we have in Canada, the environment is like 10 times worse in China. And they have real serious issues on almost every front and have so far had very poor environmental controls. Now, there are some positive signs coming from China, partly because you talk to scientists and some of their politicians, although not really required to get public input, it seems, but have a scientific background and realize some of the worst hit places in the world are going to be China. And they're realizing that, you know, agriculture, health, human health is the one, just the black carbon. You mentioned the smog or the black carbon in the atmosphere. I don't even want to think of what the cancer rates or the asthma rates are going to be in 10, 15 years in these cities. And that's a major economic issue, you know? I mean, you might say it's economic to try and fix the problem. What's the economic issue of having all these people not able to work on some sort of public assistance, chemotherapy, the list starts going. So I think they are, you know, there's been a proclamation in China about black carbon to get, or this carbon, I think one thing about being in a place like China, I'm not at all saying this is a good way of doing things, but things can happen quickly in China. You know, democracy is the best form of government, but it's messy and slow. You know, things seem tend to. I'm in China, and it's like, you know, things can change pretty quickly there. Not saying it's a good way, but I'm hopeful that. But they have real serious problems. I mean, and not just the air, the water. Always I say, if I think I've got a bad problem here, I'll fly off to Shanghai or Beijing and see. I'll put a whole new perspective on what a big problem is. Yes. That's a very good question. We're changing the environment. Do I see any evolutionary or change in my organisms? And the short answer in the organisms I work on, no. And one can wonder, you know, one of the assumptions that I've made here, it's actually a very good question, is one of the assumptions I've made here is that the ecology of my indicators hasn't changed over time. But I have data to show that's a fair assumption. And one reason is, for example, if I say a diatom indicates low ice or high ice, how do you know it hasn't all changed because of increase in greenhouse gases or some other type of pollutant? It evolved to be a different ecology. It appears that the indicators we use are extremely conservative in their ecology and their physiology. And how do I know that? Well, I know that from a variety of sources. One, and it's not proof yet, but they look identical. I can look at the same diatom 10,000, 12,000 years ago and today, they look identical. That's not proof. But often, one of the measuring sticks of evolution is morphology and morphometry. They look identical. But why do I think the ecology hasn't changed? Well, we're not only using one species at a time. We're typically using hundreds of different indicators at the same time. And we're using botanical, zoological, and sometimes non-biological isotopes, chemistry, and so forth. We see the same consistent changes in all these organisms. The chances that chance evolution and mutations all happen in the same direction of all these different indicators is really pretty well impossible. And the final point is, I'm showing 100% change in species. If they were evolving, it would be blunting, it would making the changes less striking because they'd be evolving to the new conditions.
yet I have a whole total 100% species turnover here. So clearly there's new environmental pressures changing these taxa. So I think we can pretty well pinpoint that they haven't been evolving in any significant, some evolution's always happening, of course, but they haven't been evolving in any significant way over that time to the new conditions. Oh, yep, yeah, it's hard to see hands here because of the lights. Oh, very good question. Chance comes to, how did I choose Cape Herschel? I didn't really choose it. It was an opportunity. I was doing my PhD on Ontario lakes, and there was I met, and this is a good point for young people going to conferences and so on. I met a geologist from the Geological Survey of Canada in Ottawa, who worked on glaciers in the Arctic, and he saw me give I think my first international talk, and he came to talk to me and says that's really interesting, and then he said, you know, I have some sediment, and for totally different reason. He was taking sediment to see when the glacier moved, a totally different question. And he says, I have some sediment, you might want to look at it and see if there's anything in there. And I looked at one core, and I saw these diatoms, and I wrote a paper with him, and he was quite impressed. And then all of a sudden I got this phone call saying he had an expedition going in 1983, and he had one spot available, and asked, would you be interested in going? Going, my God, I'm a guy, you know, I grew up in Montreal and stuff, and I'm going, where is this 80 degrees north latitude? So I went, I figured it was an opportunity of a lifetime. It's not an easy place to get to, so I went. Problem with the Arctic, it's so beautiful, you go once or twice too often, you end up going when you got hair like this, so I'm still going. I'm an old guy up there. But 33 or so years later, I'm still going. But that's how it started. Started by chance, and I just went from there. Anyone's has. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And you'll see a few of the slides over again at the beginning, because the introduction's similar.